You think you know about relationships, but you're wrong. Listen, there's no magic bullet. I'm teaching life skills.
When he's sick, you need medicine. It don't always taste good.
Oh, nah.
But it'll get you better. You need this medicine.
Yeah.
It ain't gonna always taste good, but this is what you need. Men and women, bottom line, we need to have the conversation. Your partner wants to give up control, but only if you know how to drive. This is about being the best you could ever be, whoever you are. I don't care if you're a man, a woman, LGBTQ, space aliens. I'll save anybody. I don't care. I'll teach a hedgehog how to have a threesome.
What do you mean by that?
Look, you don't have to listen to me, but you're wrong.
Listen, I know I'm great. And I know you're thinking, Dante, there's no way I could be like you. But you could be me. You know why?
Because you know who I was? Before I was me, I was you. You
man score 202.
Better hear what I've got to say because you won't get it again.
I'm not an alpha male. I'm not a beta male either. I'm just a better man. Better man.
Well, put your happiness first, because if you don't, they won't.
What's up, Square Pimper Game? Yo, this is GYBB. Get your balls back. WWDD, What Would Dante Do? The Sexual Revolution is being podcasted, and I am excited. Harry, what's going on? You good?
Oh, Dante, you know me. Having a tough time keeping these gators down.
It is difficult. Yeah,
it's not easy.
It's not easy, but with a lot of practice, it's easy to keep them down. Andre is at the beach or something. I don't know.
He's
doing something.
Lifting something heavy, probably.
Yeah, so he's not in today.
Smoking and lifting something heavy.
He's definitely smoking. Definitely smoking. We got a special guest today. This is my dog, man. I love this dude to death. One of the funniest dudes I know. He wrote for everybody's Comedy Central, all kinds of shit. Give it up for my boy, Kurt Metzger, y'all. Give it up for Kurt Metzger.
What's up, man?
What's going on, baby? How you doing?
I'm all right. I'm not in San Francisco. Don't be fooled by this. It's not. You know it's not real because it's not orange.
Oh, it's not on fire.
It's not on fire.
That's how you could tell.
Dude, I thought I was fucking dying.
Really?
Like, I couldn't catch my breath. I just walked like a short distance, a couple days in a row. I just went outside a short distance and I just couldn't catch my breath. And I'm like, oh shit, I must be getting COVID.
Yeah.
And then I found out, I was talking to somebody.
It was
like,
the ash.
Out. She goes, yeah, you know, the air quality is like, you're not supposed to be outside at all. It's really turning to China out here.
You didn't notice that you were crawling on the ground gasping for air. You was like, this is weird, right?
I was like, woo, so time to celebrate with a good vape.
Yeah. It's ironic because you're a hardcore smoker for a while, Kurt, weren't you, for a bit?
Yeah.
Yeah. So
quit everything for a while. I just have been going fucking batshit from being in my house, so I fucking took up
What do you pick back up? Did you go back to the religious thing? Because that would be the ultimate.
You're Jehovah Witness
you
again?
Go back to being
No, I had quit all this like nicotine shit. Like I wasn't doing any of it, but then I was like, who cares? Who cares if I live or die?
I was like, I thought you was gonna like, you know, I was walking out selling watchtowers and I took that back up too, but
well,
no.
You know, when I was Jehovah's Witness, we didn't sell the watchtowers. They were free with an optional donation if you wanted. But the important thing was to get that watchtower in your hands.
Oh, just to get it to you.
By the way, they're probably selling like hockey. I'll bet you watchtowers are selling like toilet paper and ammo right now.
Oh, because of the
end of the world coming.
Explain that. I don't understand the watchtower thing. Maybe I'm missing something.
It's the title of it's the Jehovah Witness magazine's.
Oh, okay.
Watchtower. You didn't know that?
I didn't.
So you never had the Jehovah's Witness knocking on your door on Saturdays trying to get in to talk to you about Jesus?
We never made it that far to the sales pitch for the free magazine. We usually shut the door pretty quick.
Yeah.
Except for my dad, actually.
Orthodox or something?
My dad actually would sit there and talk to those guys for fun or whatever. He loved talking to anybody who wanted to talk religion. Just to break balls, I guess, for whatever reason. So he's
your dad wasn't
Mormon.
Like religious. He was just like fucking around, or
he is religious, but like he doesn't organized religion, and he wasn't. Yeah, he wasn't talking to them about finding
a lot
the way
of people
of
like dude. A lot of people like talking about that shit, and it's not like you know what happens is any kind of thing, any kind of proselytizing thing hits you at some point that you need it. And that's how you come. You don't, you know, that's not just Jehovah's Witnesses. They always say it convicts your heart and not your head. And that's how people go into it. Like if somebody knocks on your door at a low point and then you're like, oh, this does sound good. And then, you know, the people are generally nice. And that's, you know, that's how people
until you get in.
Well, it's not the things that like made me want to go out of it were not because, you know, the good stuff about it was it wasn't political on purpose because you're not supposed to be and be a Christian. It wasn't there's no like going to war. There was no it was completely, you know, all the sinister shit from Christianity is really only scary once they start trying to legislate laws.
Right.
Once you take that out of it and there's like complete nonviolence, like that removes a lot. Now, the main problem with it is you have to subvert your personal issues for the good of the group. So, because you don't want to stumble your brother, as the scripture says, out of the truth. And so, like, that's how bad shit can happen, you know? That's why the greatest, the biggest settlement in history for some kind of molestation thing is in Jehovah's Witnesses. Not
yeah,
that.
I was just, I, it's funny.
Is that true? Wow.
Dude, I just watched a doc on it, right?
Because I was in a doc. Was that the one I'm in? Because I just did. I was just
are you in? I didn't see you in it. But I mean, it's a couple of series. I don't even know where I was, but they were saying how there was this huge, like, pedophilia thing going on. Not so much.
You're talking about, okay, someone smuggled out records of like stuff like that happened that was at the Watchtower Society. They all do the same thing. And it's only Jehovah's Witnesses, but all the religions.
All organized religions, yeah.
Every, like, colleges, Congress, the whole idea is don't make the organization look bad. We're going to handle this in-house. It's very much mirrors the college horse shit where, like, a fucking feminist tribunal decides with no involvement. And they get... they get to have a little bit of power in their heads, like, "Well, we're gonna make it so you're not going to college anymore, rapist. Take that." Mm. And then, meanwhile, the college is like indemnifying itself because right. they're known as a place where fucking rapes happen because they let everybody fucking drink themselves into oblivion.
Right, so right.
It's like a con, you know.
In all fairness, with that before, wasn't it a situation where the colleges handled it and just didn't go to the police for a while too? Wasn't it like on the other spectrum?
Well, they tried to keep it.
Yeah.
Like, well,
now they don't go to the police. They you know, that's one good thing that what's her name did. I don't really know. I know people don't like her. What's it, DeVos? She fucking struck Betsy down DeVos. Title IX, that evil fucking shit that they installed at the colleges, where you don't get to defend yourself. Someone just says something and you're out.
Okay. Which,
remember Mattress Girl and all that bullshit?
Yeah.
I don't agree with that nonsense. Yeah.
It's a little hypocritical when you got fucking, then when it's like Biden's turn, you're like, we need due process. Like, you fucking fuck. You fucking made that. Like, we must believe women immediately with no vetting. That's the message beforehand. Then all of a sudden, when a Jew.
Oh, yes. Especially, you're right. Joe Biden, who was one of the people basically berating Anita Hill.
Oh yeah,
during those Clarence Thomas testimonies.
That shit is cringeworthy when you watch Biden and
especially
you watch
him in hindsight.
Yeah, but the I was watching the doc and what happens because I don't know if you know this. I don't know if I told you this, but I grew up with like all my best friends were Jehovah's Witness.
Oh, really? Where'd you grow up in New York?
I'm in Brooklyn. Yeah. They had a Kingdom Hall right in Crown Heights.
The headquarters was in Brooklyn for a long time.
Yeah, over the Watchtower. When you go over the bridge, you could see it to the right of the Brooklyn Bridge.
Yeah, they sold that for a lot of money, I bet.
Yeah,
I never saw anybody living rich.
Yeah, no. I mean, I didn't, you know, I don't think it was so much that, but there was a buddy of mine, his sister got caught fucking.
Right.
And she had to go in front of the whole congregation.
Well, that's not what probably would have, because they don't do it like that. What they do is you have to go to the elders and then the elders announce. They, like, whoever's given the talk, they announce Sister So-and-So has been reproved. Or if you don't repent of your fornications, then they'll say So-and-So has been disfellowshipped, which is like...
excommunicate, like...
Yeah, and people, some people get real fucked up because depending on how wackadoo your family is in it, they'll cut you off. Like, my mother could never do that with her kids, so it wasn't like that for me, but some people it is like that.
Oh yeah, they definitely. I had friends of mine who absolutely got cut out. Like two of my best friends right now, and I've known for 30 years. Their mother is so. His little brother is bipolar, and he, like, the woman is, she's probably pushing 80, and he kind of roughed up his mom because his sister was always like a scumbag, and she basically, like, they have a house over here, and all of them have their own houses, and she basically told the little brother, who's a little off, that that he had no part in the house. Like, if they died, the house is going to the girls, and it doesn't even, that's what the father did. And he came, kicked the door in to look at the papers and stuff. But she kind of conned she knew the brother's off. So she conned the brother to come and basically beat up I kind of feel like he was trying to get him to, like, hurt his mom where the hole where she could get the house. It was some real disco shit. But but the brother, who is kind of, you know, the kind dude, like the door was hanging off the hinges and shit. So he came all the way in to fix, you know, to fix the door, because the other brothers, they didn't give a fuck. The ones that are in still in the hall, they didn't give a fuck. And he came in to fix, and she was like, she can't talk to him. Like, her door is hanging off the fucking hinges, and he was like, because he was kind of.
By the way, that's not a thing you have to do. Like, not everybody does that. It depends how.
Yeah,
like,
how deep they're in.
Yeah, like I remember my sister when I left was like, my mom probably didn't talk to me for like a month when I went.
Right.
My sister.
Did you have a conversation, or?
She just knew I was fucking in college, so she I don't know. She just sensed that. I was,
did she find out? Like, did you leave proof, or did she just figuring it out? Like,
you sent her full condoms.
Some girl had like drawn on. Some girl had drawn on my belt buckle, and my mom was like, "Why the fuck is there a little?" Like, it was not something I would do, and you know, just my mom. So, and she said, "No, you know, she's fucking nosy," and so I was faking that I was still in for a little bit. And then I was like, I don't give a shit. I can't sit through this. It's just the tedium of sitting through that and the meetings. It's like 3 meetings a week. And then the fucking bullshit of, like, I don't think that the governing body is talking to God more than, like, I could myself. Like, I don't buy any of that. And also, I don't like that shit where you have family problems. Like, bipolar, you mentioned. My mother's bipolar, okay? Which we found out, you know, years later, she gets a diagnosis after years of misery and her making us go to therapy.
Right.
It turns out
that's lovely.
What a fucking surprise. So, you know, you have these elders, they didn't help us. Like, the elders are going to counsel your family. The fucking guy who's an elder is a fucking plumber. He's not a goddamn therapist. What the fuck is he? So the thing is, they sell it to you as the one solution for all your problems is the Bible.
Right.
So, like, if there's all kinds of stuff in the Bible that's helpful, but, like, don't, if you sell it to me as, like, this is the infallible solution to every single thing in my life, nobody would have talked me out of the religion with evidence. Like, that doesn't work.
Right.
It's not until it doesn't help you how it's supposed to when you're vulnerable to leaving that kind of belief system.
Well, they also, I remember them, they didn't, their father never encouraged them to go to college and stuff. They always told them to take a trade. But I think, I don't know.
Yeah, they used to say that when I was young, but they kind of eased off of that at a certain point. But that was a lot of people where that, like, my dad didn't go to college because he was, like, they call it pioneering, and you just knock on doors all day because the world's about to end any minute. So why would you waste your time with that? I mean, honestly, nowadays, you're probably better off learning a trade. I don't know. Like, everybody's got debt and a degree shit, so that's fucking fine.
Yeah, but when we were younger, it was get your education, go to college and stuff, and it was also a matter of them not wanting to be part of the secular world. Like, so a lot
definitely
of them,
that definitely that because you're that's what happened to me. I went to art school with other Jehovah's Witnesses. That's why I was kind of at ease us going to, like, Philly from our town. I was with my childhood friends that were Jehovah's Witnesses, and friends that from my neighborhood all went to the same school. We were roommates, you know?
Yeah.
And it's just, once you're out of the communal reinforcement, it's way easier to, like, especially if you had doubts as you left.
Yeah.
There's nothing to push those down now.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's also that kind of, you're right. It's like, I always say to, like, guys in Mormons, you know, they'll have 5 wives. It's not because they have game. There's the agency over them says that this is what you should do. And so everybody kind of,
you're talking about the FLDS.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Like, the official Mormons can't do that. I would say like regular Mormons that don't allow that are the same kind as Jehovah's Witnesses, where you're not supposed to be doing anything sexual as a teen or even dating or any of that. Mm-hmm. So these are people that are fucking pent up and so they want to get married. And, you know, there's a lot of like shitty marriage. Like I found out my Kingdom Hall later, all these people were fucking each other's wives and shit.
Really?
Wow. Yeah. All these people like cheat on each other that were like the young. When I would go to the assemblies at like Veterans Stadium, the top row was where all like the bad Jehovah's Witness kids hang out. The ones that have like a secret tattoo.
The cool,
you know,
the cool Jehovah's Witness kids.
Yeah. Like
I wasn't back one of the stadium. Cool ones.
They were usually like richer and they could, you know, afford to go on like activities together. And they always were like, ended up fucking each other and getting tattoos and that kind of, you know, it's amazing to me, like the amount of them that are still in it. Cause I left and, shit. Sorry. My phone's going off. Mm-hmm. I left and, all these people are still in. They got in bad marriages, or like I knew one kid was gay, and like he left because he was gay, and then came back and married a girl, and say he wasn't gay anymore. So that should work out great.
He just showed up. Guess what, everybody? I don't suck dicks anymore.
Like, I have a real. I don't regret that I was in it because it's like a inoculation against that kind of group. Like the craving of, well, I got over that feeling of like the womb of your group.
Yeah, yeah.
Losing that. So
well, you know, I was saying this, it's literally like being a it's like being a conformist in a nonconformist group.
So, yes, right. That's exactly right. Mm-hmm.
And so there's a comfort in that. I recommend this to anybody. I don't know if you saw the documentary on the flat earthers.
No, but I mean, I know flat earth.
There's a doc on it. And one of the things that's really interesting is how these guys have not, they're all kind of weird, kind of outcast dudes. And they found their way into this group where they can feel validated within the group. And so it doesn't even matter whether they're proven wrong or not proven wrong.
That's why it's silly to fucking even. Well, I remember Flat Earth Dave from
I did a Race Wars with you guys with him there.
And he, so, you know, it makes me laugh when people, if I would debate anybody, like if I was still Christian, like evolution or if I was want to debate against a Christian, I would never bother with the evidence or the math. It's like when I would argue with Will Silvins about if 9/11 was an inside job because he's like steel melts it to, you know, all that kind of shit.
Yeah.
I'm like, well, fucker, you don't know about steel and I don't know about steel. Like, so we can cut all that shit.
You can't Will Silvins can't say spaghetti.
I wish that I had that retort. Well, you can't fucking say spaghetti.
But here you are trying to intellectually argue, like, look, you don't know about steel. I don't know about steel.
Yeah, so like, my thing is like, dude, maybe you have the flat earth formula. But like, I don't how the fuck do I know? Well, who is hiding this? First of all, who gives a shit what shape the world is? How does that affect me in any way?
Yeah.
Who's hiding this? And how many motherfuckers are in on this?
Flat Earth Dave was in the doc, you know.
Oh yeah, I'm sure. But he's one of the ones that's a little fruitier because he'll tell. See, the ones that are smarter, like, I don't know why they're lying about it. That's the guy that's a little smarter because he knows there's no any answer is going to be like, here's where the bull. Dave though is like, well, it's, you know, a plot to keep us away from
Us stupid. Yeah.
Vibrations low so we can't contact God or some shit. Like, that's part where I'm like,
forgot he went that
he doubles down on another conspiracy.
Oh, yeah, because he doubles down on a bunch of guys.
He's into all, he's into all of them. So I'm just like, dude, has anything ever happened? Like, anything?
Yeah.
Number one. And two, who has to be in on this? So it's like NASA, the airline industry, mm-hmm. fucking all of scientists.
A lot of people.
And they're in on this for what?
For what like, purpose?
Around the world, countries that hate each other. They get together on this, that the Earth is flat. That's the treaty we have, and we're going to keep you out of Antarctica.
It's funny because, like, when I did your podcast and we were talking to him, you and I were kind of saying this. Look, let's say you're right. Mm. How come? Why? Why? What's the purpose of it? I mean, are we selling flat Earth globes?
There's an obsession. If they're religious, there's the ones that say, I don't know. They're being like coy.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like I said, like, you know, when Dave Chappelle would say, like, I don't think we landed on the moon. Or like, he's a smart dude. That's just a fuck you whitey kind of thing. So the guys are smart enough not to say it.
Right. It's
like a fuck you thing. And then the other ones, they believe in all this other lizards have an obsession. This is, and I don't really understand this. They have this obsession that if we, the Earth is just a speck in a giant universe, that somehow it's like a plot to make you feel less important than you are. Which, okay, to me, it's like if it's the Earth is just a tiny speck and we're the only life we know of, doesn't that make you more precious?
You see, the problem is, this is what I always say. You know, when you try to think logical and you use critical thinking, you're always trying to make sense out of nonsense. And the minute you go down that road, like you're like, instead of just going, you can't say spaghetti, right?
I will say to give it to them on one level, like the fact that there's all these people getting to flat Earth is the same reason a bunch of people are becoming Jehovah's Witnesses.
And
a bunch
of people are becoming, absolutely,
because you literally cannot trust any of the institutions. The level of not being able to trust anything now is so over the top that people of all intellects are going to find their comfort thing to escape from the bullshit that you get thrown at you by every establishment thing.
What
percentage of people you think it is that are now in cults that just wouldn't have been? You know, because now it's easy to find all this stuff online. Back in the day, like...
Well, it's worse because now you have a... This is the same thing that happened with the Proud Boys and the MGTOWs, because these were guys who were really scared of women and trying to find a place to fit in, and there's nothing better than a nerd to make. They make the best websites with graphics and intros. They edit video, and so now you have this.
Antifa started lifting.
They are really skinny. Really skinny.
Well, there's like the fuck. Like I always thought it was amazing. I mean, I know Gavin ended up kind of like practiced himself from his prank that got out of hand.
The prank that got out of hand.
A joke.
It really was.
That's the best way to describe it, is Gavin's whole career.
Yeah.
It's a prank that got way out of hand.
Well, yeah, so they would, what do you call it? He would get, you know, I remember he slipped in his Catholic shit to these guys. He basically just sold them Catholic shit of like no wanks.
Well, that was me. You know,
really?
Yeah, that was me. Because the way that happened was, I said that I had stopped watching porn and stopped jerking off, because I felt like when you jerk off, you don't have that. It takes the wolf away, that wolf. And so if you got a kid who's really already definitely afraid of being rejected by women in the first place, and then you do the no wanks thing, then he really has no, he's afraid and he's kind of satiated. So he's lazy and he's lazy and afraid, which is the worst combination. But I just said, I was on Gavin's show and I just said, you know,
he was on board with that immediately.
He was, I was like, I don't. And he was like, really? And I said, yeah, I feel
is
like,
that right?
Yeah. Because, you know, I had the whole, I was involved with them and all. You remember
right,
that?
Yeah.
I mm-hmm. So I said, I basically was like, I don't do it. And he goes, get the fuck out. I was like, no, I find that I have more energy. I'm more aggressive. It makes me more aggressive, which is the same reason why you don't fuck before a fight or something, you know? So he goes, you know what? I'll give it a shot. He goes, how about a month? And I go, how about 6 months? And he was like, fuck no, I can't. I'm not doing it for 6 months. And I was like, all right, how about a month? Right. And then
isn't that the level of Gavin's like perspective is to challenge you on something you say you already do.
And
double down on the amount that he could do the bet with.
I can't believe that Dante is responsible for half creating these fights in the street.
I absolutely am.
jerk off aggression.
and then it became this whole thing. And so every time I would go back to Gavin's show, the whole Proud Boy thing just kept evolving. So then they had I'm Proud of Your Boy, the song from Aladdin. Then he had a bell. Then it was like the breakfast cereal things, like the second initiation where you get punched by a bunch of guys and you have to name five breakfast cereals. And then it was like, And it was just like, it just seemed so.
I remember
so,
when you were telling me about all that. And I go, yeah, Dante, what the fuck are you doing?
And I was just, I really was just trying to, I mean, you know, Kurt, you know me a long time. I was just trying to help well, these
is,
dudes.
By the way, not jerking off is such like grown man advice. You yeah, know what I mean? Like, yeah. That's like your late 30s. You want to look into that. That's yeah, yeah. A young man's got a lot of pent up aggression, like better, a bonobo yeah, monkey.
Get
that's
that
gotta
poison
get
out. Yeah. Yeah, as Keith would put it, get the point. You got to get the poison out. Yeah. So,
it's for a grown man that fucking.
Ah, you know, sir, Dante, you gotta get the poison out. Dude. So
Keith Robinson, by the way, the only guy who's happy that he gets to wear a mask now when he goes out in public, by his own admission, he's thrilled he now gets to creep with a mask on.
Wait, who does?
Keith Robinson.
So the thing, it just kept evolving. It kept evolving. And then there was a Facebook page and it was a website. And then it was, then they had the colors and then the yeah, polo right. shirts. And then meanwhile,
this is the thing. Like, it's really something. It's like a virus bacteria. Like yeah. on the other end, there's a whole bunch of people in the street doing. So it's a natural, like fucking Gangs of New York thing that starts to happen.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
And then they and then it stokes each other up. You know that there's a gang out here called White Fence.
No, what is that?
The Mexican gang.
Oh no,
but,
okay.
But it started as a church softball team.
Oh,
you know, so that's how a lot of shit starts. Is
yeah,
like
yeah, yeah,
something
yeah.
kind of like innocuous, even just
well, the black man, husband, you know,
the Nazi black parties. Start out as a pickup basketball game. Is that true?
Black Panther started as a breakfast program.
That was actually true.
Yeah.
Well, no, that's true. I mean, yeah. like, here's my tinfoil hat thing. I think a lot of these things are, especially like you think Black Panther's like a lot of this like Antifa horse shit. I don't know. I would make a bet on it if you could bet on it that there's intelligence agencies that want to stoke up as many like. So a bunch of, I don't know if you saw, they hacked the fucking Antifa message boards and they had like their battle plans, you know, for like yeah, how yeah, to yeah. do their protest and like
yeah,
the
yeah, fourth. Yeah.
So the majority of these people are like dippy Portland fruity kids. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it's just like Charles Manson. You got your fucking hippie kids and you yeah. disrespect hippie kids, and then you got your Mansons that come in.
Yeah.
So they do all the groups. There's the ones that hold the flag. There's the ones that.
Somebody's got to make the brownies.
yeah, there's like snacks and shit. And then you see the fire mages, which is such a nerd way. And that's the people burning shit.
Yeah.
And then the light mages, which is the people with the lasers. So they're fucking, it's really interesting because you can see like the vast majority of them are just dipshits, which I'm sure is how the Proud Boys are. But if you how,
absolutely. It was just a bunch of dudes who didn't get laid. And they dug right. me because... They dug me because of the fact that what I was talking about,
they have no masculine, like,
yeah, right,
that shit
exactly.
is so systematically broken down. It really is amazing the amount to turn you into a bitch by society. Like,
sure.
when you'd hear about the fashion magazines, like, girls see that magazine, they think they have, and I, because I'm a guy, I'm like, well, we'll buy the magazine then. Like, what? I don't even understand the need to fucking.
This is what I say whenever I talk about you. This is the thing that I say yeah. about you that Kurt has accidental game because
but just I had masculine pre. Like I wouldn't think I'm not inherently like I'm compulsive. So I'm
no.
not like, brave.
Yeah, yeah.
I would say
yeah.
I'm brave. I just can't help being how I'm gonna be. But I had like very strong masculine influences looking out for me where. That's like that silliness of like, I have to have everybody approve of me. That's something that chicks used to do. But now there's an effort is to like feminize you. Like you should worry what everyone thinks about you all the time, like a teenage girl. And you should do it well into your 30s. That's the fucking message. Because
well, here's the thing. When I know dudes who are masculine, I know plenty of dudes who are masculine. Then when they come to their girl, they're straight bitches. Just.
Oh, absolutely. I'm just saying that level where you need to tell them to maybe stop jerking off because they can't even talk to a girl. I don't mean like, because of course there's that. Of course there's that. It's yeah. just the, you know, like, it's like a mix of, like, autism. Just like you see a younger generation.
Sure.
They're
sure.
like fucking Jaden Smith's on the manly end of these kids, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
Like, and that's like a, what's cool. It's like when I don't know. There's always phases of that. Like when the 80s, you had all like Charlie Murphy would tell the story about if you could look the most like a bitch, that was the goal.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
You know,
yeah,
like,
yeah,
like,
yeah.
So that shit's been around forever,
yeah.
you know?
Yeah, it's I think it's a human thing. It's just a way right. where you, I don't know if you call it beta males, but I mean, it's just people who are insecure are looking for something to latch on and looking for this validation. But what I was saying about you is, yeah, I guess, yeah, you have masculine figures, but you also are very different in that you are kind of, okay, this is what it is. Let me pick this apart and figure this out.
That's from Jehovah's Witnesses. That's from being in it and then leaving it. That's from
from actually picking it apart and then going, also, I'm not doing this.
Also from it's like a weird thing, but if you can learn how to draw, then that it helps that, because anybody could draw if they took the time to learn the skill. It's a map making skill.
Right.
And what happens is when you learn to read and all that, you get symbols in your head for things. So, you know, that's why you see people draw like an L for a nose or whatever. So you literally just got, it's something you probably could have done better before you went to school. Like naturally is just draw what you see. Just what do you see?
Uh-huh.
Don't put what you're supposed to see.
Right.
What you imagine, what you think, just look at the lines and just draw them. Do your best to draw the lines. And
right.
I used to have this good book. It was called Drawing on the Right Side of the Brain. And they had these tricks where you'd read a book upside down. Or read a book, yeah, upside down to like get your brain out of the logic, you know, locked in kind of logical mode. And if you want to copy a drawing, you turn the drawing upside down. So that way you're not having symbolism interfere
with
just seeing what's in front of you. So that applies to like everything, I think.
I used to just play Bop It.
What's that?
You know, the game Bop It, Twist It, Turn It.
Twist it.
You know, that you have a...
Is that like a skip like, it? You're thinking of the skip it, but Dante Bop It was different. Yeah. No, Kurt's thinking of Skip It.
Oh, Bop It is it's
I
like,
thought you stopped bopping it. You're a hypocrite.
Well, it was a game that came out where you have a thing that flicks. It goes bop it, and you hit the thing, and
I kind of remember it,
right?
Yeah.
And then it's a twist it, and you had a twist thing, then you had a flick it, then you had a spin it. There was a spin it, flip it, then there was a pull it, right? And it goes doom, 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 bop it, flip it. And then you would do this kind of thing, and then it would change where each, like the spin it thing was green, and the flick it thing was yellow, and so it would go bop it, yellow, flip it. It would mix it up, so you had to go right brain, left brain, colors and art and kind of like, I used to do that shit, but it's interesting to turning it upside down. But you like, what I'm saying is you, like if a chick would say to you, listen, I don't want to see you no more, you would go, oh, okay, and then you would just not see her anymore. And not,
no, I don't, I don't, it's... You know, it might be kind of like a social retardation. Like, this is a thing
it is kind of, but I mean, it's that's
like I'm always in these situations where, because this is what else disillusioned me about Joe's was because I believed it, and then you see like the parts where you're not supposed to be taking them at their word, and you're supposed to understand this really means this. And there's and especially
which is them creating the wiggle room for you to never be wrong. Yeah.
Dude,
yeah.
And it's the higher you go up in society, like the more like upper class, the worse it gets, where we say we have a public and private position,
right.
You know, like and I would always be in situations where, hey, I'll give you a good example is Dan Powell, who's a producer, Comedy Central.
Mm-hmm.
And back when Rachel Dolezal came out. Remember her, Rachel Dolezal?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And she fucking...
There's a new one now, too, you know.
Yeah, that check. She said, I'm... this guy, Nuka Zeus, online, you should see, because he actually gets tan injections.
Oh, really?
And yeah, and I'm like... I thought it was hilarious, because I'm like... She said she's transracial, and like... You don't have a good argument why you can't be transracial, but be trans... And I remember Dan, like, come on... Like, his argument is, like, I should just know... Okay, and so I think like, well, what is it I'm just supposed to know? Oh, this is the thing we're all saying, that this is great, and you should just know that you're just going to make someone upset. That's when you get that bullshit of when, who's the guy, Adam Ruins Everything, he fucking sucks, but when he's on Rogan.
Adam Conover.
Yeah, and he was talking about, you know, Rogan got flack, which I love him for not giving a shit about, but he got flack because he said, it's not that trans women can't compete, it's they should disclose it in a combat sport. That they're trans, like the woman should have the option to be like, which like you should have the option to be like, all right, I don't know if I want to have sex with you because I, that's your, they should have the option. So Adam fucking said some dumb shit. This is how they all argue. He goes, well, you know, I talk to so many trans and they say, hey, that they're talking about giving kids hormones, you know? Right. And he goes, a lot of trans friends are actors telling me that little kid was me. And then I wouldn't have had the presence of mind to say, Rogan goes, well, it's not them. It's a separate kid. Like, it's not.
Wait, I've lost you. I lost you.
You know when they talk about, like, giving kids hormones?
Yes.
Below a certain age?
Yeah.
Five and shit. And so Adam's saying, well, so many trans people I know say, that little five-year-old was me. Everyone's like, no, that five-year-old's a separate person. They're not you.
Okay. So they're trying to broad stroke.
Trying to do this horseshit fake solidarity they all do. That's what activists. And then he did his move out of the thing was to go, well, we're not trans. We shouldn't be talking about this. Like, that's the little, like, bitch move of those arguments. Well,
that's like when you get God, uncomfortable. That's like God works in mysterious ways. Like, you want to argue the existence of God on a logical basis until you have your back to a corner, and then you go,
right. You
God,
just want to be right. I think it's you just want to be right and be with the good people. And once the questions get uncomfortable, it's time, because this is what they taught us, Jehovah's Witnesses, like, you're supposed to guard your mind. And as soon as it gets uncomfortable, a conversation, it's time to pull the fuck out. Like, if it's threatening your beliefs, you got to get out. And I watch people do that. Just
really? And that's taught.
Yeah, that's I was told there's no gray. There's only, everything's black or white as far as morals. If it's gray, it's black. You know? Like, I literally took stupid lessons as a kid. So,
right.
Like, especially now, I see that. That's why I say, like, all these people that are, like, supposedly secular atheists, I don't think they're qualified, a lot of them, to be that. Like, if I wanted to be an atheist, I'm qualified because I understand what it is I'm getting away from.
Right.
But these people, especially if they're not raised in a religion, they do not fundamentally understand religion. They filter through whatever lens. So if they're political, that's where you get all this shit about, like, you know, Islamophobia is a form of racism, which it's not. But that's a political move to equate it like anti-Semitism, which, by the way, should cover Islamophobia because they're Semites. But that's the move, is marketing, PR. Like, people understand racism is bad. I associate with this thing. It's not technically correct, but the greater good.
here's the honest thing about it is because if you really, so we, you know, the three principles of man school is authenticity, credibility, and empathy.
Yeah.
Hey, tell the truth.
I think that's great.
And tell the truth. Mean what you say. Say what you mean. If you say you're going to do something, you do it. If you say, mean, be accountable to yourself and what comes out your mouth. And have the empathy to see the kind of pain and stuff that other people are going through, to see what, take that into consideration in your decisions.
Do you know, I don't know if you remember this, like, because I used to see these, like, arguments, like, you know, like, if somebody's, like, racist online, when they would have their shit about, you know, black males have more testosterone. It used to make me laugh, like, you'd have these, like, racist people that black guys have extra testosterone and it makes them aggressive. They almost sound like feminists. They have, it makes them aggressive, and they, that's like, I'm a white guy, so I'm the porridge that's just right.
I'm the perfect amount. I'm the baby bed.
But when they study how testosterone works, that's not in animals. They have excess. You know what it does mostly? It makes animals more fair, like in chimpanzees.
Oh, okay. Really?
It actually makes them more fair with each other.
Okay.
That's not what, so
more,
it's not
logical,
just a,
more logical, more across the board, I guess.
It's just more like, and if you think about it, like, because you always had that great thing about, like, the benevolent king thing of not having to grow someone into the earth once you,
right,
you know,
once,
I mean?
once you've made your point and you've established, I wouldn't say dominance, but just your own personal boundaries, just
dominance over yourself, and no one's gonna tell, like, which is what's fair. So, right. Like, that's why I always say, with, like, when we were, I was on the road with Lewis, and, like, and I had the same, because I had, like, my mom's bipolar and shit, so the kind of anger I have in me, I don't consider it to be masculine. I consider it to be, like, my feminine side.
Yeah.
It's like, if I'm set off, which, I mean, better now because I'm older and shit, but the thing that would set me off is a fucking mind snap, and, like, you're going to pay for this, and everything that was ever done by anyone. Like, right. A chick. Because you don't have to be a woman to experience it. It's just, I consider it like feminine anger. I don't consider it like masculine.
Yeah. Well, it definitely is. I mean, you know, I think it's so even with that, I don't necessarily masculine and feminine, but I go dominant and submissive more so now. I don't really
top or bottom, but
you know why? I'm going to tell you why, yeah. Because I've done consultations with lesbians and I've seen like the more, you know, the dykey.
You know, it's not a woman's this way and a man's this way.
Everybody, right.
Both of those things in them.
Yes.
Animus.
At some point, no matter how dominant maybe both of you are, somebody has to make a decision and somebody has
somebody
to
is just more aggressive, more dominant or more dominant in the situation.
I think somebody knows what they're talking about, I got no problem deferring to them. I've never had an issue.
That's a very masculine thing to do to be able to concede with the fact that, oh, I'm not aware of this. And as opposed right. to wanting to seem as though you know what you're talking about, which goes back to the authenticity.
Right. Wanting to seem like that's the shit that just bugs the shit out of me.
Yeah.
Or and wanting for it to be right more than
winning. It's just like
wanting to be right rather than true.
Right.
I want to know I'm with the good people. And I've seen
I think that's the thing that's gotten you, a lot of people confused about you throughout your career, Kurt, a little bit, because you've always been a guy who is pretty empathetic.
He tries to pitch it. He tries to pitch
first, though.
Yeah. He tries to pitch it down the middle.
Also, you got to figure in, like, I pissed off some fucking Fruit Loop feminist blogger who led like a political campaign to like smear me. So it's really like a lot of it is just that there's an entire. I mean, it's when the personal is political, that became a thing of your whole life is a dirty campaign against your political enemies.
Right.
So like, I wouldn't even conceive of how to be politically smart about how to say something like, yeah. I'm just like,
well, exactly what I mean about your game is almost idiot savant. Like
what Dan Powell said.
Yeah, it's really kind of, like so cut and dry. I think I if I had to critique, sometimes I think there's a historical perspective that needs to be considered in the context of that sometimes, or sometimes there's variables that are not considered or not you talk obviously about,
what's his name, I'm blanking now.
Oh,
because I meant to ask you never told me the blind spot with Nick Cannon.
Oh, what do you mean with him? Oh, when we were talking about
I never found out. You're like, I think you got a blind spot with that, but I never found out what it was.
Well, what I would say is that what we talked about when we were talking about, you were talking about the Nick Cannon thing. So Harry, fill you in.
Yeah,
we're talking about the Nick Cannon thing and they were talking about Nick Cannon and I go.
Which thing? Melanin thing?
Thing. And it's which is interesting because he said, you know, the thing that they initially got on him is because he says, NBC is stands for nigga, be careful. Right. Which is one of the reasons why he got canceled.
Does stand for that, by the way.
Yeah, it was a weird business choice.
By the way, the network also ABC, CBS, CNN,
they all say it's the motto. And then they jumped on him for that, and then they canceled him because he said that.
What do you mean? He lost his job or?
He lost his job with
America's
NBC.
Got Talent gig
because of that.
If I remember, I don't remember why he said that. Too, it's weird how
he said it in his stand. I can't say it.
You don't want to call it stand up.
What is it about bad stand up and
his humorous TED talk?
Yes, yeah, he did it in his stand up. Special. He said it in standard special. So even in the context of this, that he was joking, they took his job, which is really, nigga, be careful. You know, I mean, that's it.
Yeah, I don't. I know all that. I understand that. Like, he's saying his thing that he said was racist is not like, I don't give a shit if it's race. Like, I'm not like, I don't think
right.
A lot of people have racism, and they might have like a good reason to them for it.
I'm also being when we talked about it, I said it's I'm also speculating, so I can't really say. But I said
I think you were right. I think it was like a prove you. First of all, the thing of
let me prove my blackness.
I watched it happen with Owen Benjamin, like same kind of Nick Tanner chance. He got fucked, and also he was getting more. We'll say he was taking a lot of Adderall because the last time I saw him, he was giving me Adderall. Which, thank you, Owen. I always liked him. It's not like that. I dislike him now. It's just that he's like He's gone. He's disillusioned with shit to the point of, and I would say he's almost like a white version of Nick Cannon in terms of like that kind of like, you know, he's like a fun piano comic you can bring to your Hollywood party.
Right.
And they reject his very essence, you know? Right. So everybody will snap once you realize how the fucking beast works. But Owen now is a moon denier. Not a moon landing denier.
That's what?
A moon denier.
He doesn't believe there's the moon.
Now, if you know the black guy, I don't believe we land on the moon. Well, guess what? You've checkmate because he doesn't believe the fucking moon. He has surpassed you, sir.
And, to be able to laugh at someone and go, you think there's a moon.
But it's like people get hurt, like this shit, people get hurt by this, how evil this shit is, depending on where, you know, intellect, emotional state. And then, you know, like the more shit that, and then people start coming at them, and they're like, go ahead, say another thing, I'm gonna stop believing the sky. I don't believe in clouds now.
One more fucking, you open one more word.
Yeah. And the people, like, there's a really great documentary on Netflix from this chick. She's Pakistani from England. She's fucking hot too, and she's a journalist, and she went to the Taliban and like talked to them. And she went to all these kind of, like, it was right after Charlottesville, kind of like either Nazi or, you know, Klansmen,
full spectrum. Like,
and she's like, and she's talking to him like, "Do you think that I should be kicked out of the country?" Like, and you could see first of all, every single guy, or not Richard Spencer. Like, they talked to Richard Spencer. Like, he's a closet. He clearly a gay guy.
Yeah,
which I never hear anybody bring up that he's obviously a queer. Okay, which is like classic, like, you know, old school Nazi, where you got some closet gays at the top,
and
then you have an army of molested boys. So she's talking to this one guy, and he's talking about, you know, and you can, and she's just being nice. She's not saying shit to him. She's just asking him, "Why do you think this?" And he's like excited. He looked like Nick Cannon talking to Professor Griff about his new. And he's like,
"I don't think you should go if you fuck me."
No, that was my joke. She's like, "You think these titties should leave the country?" Like, no, I didn't say not those titties. No. But he tells a story about, you know, she asked about his background, and he was talking about, like, first he talks about how he hated his mom's boyfriend, and then he's talking about how he didn't want to go to graduation because he didn't want to wear a dress. And I'm like, oh, okay, I see what happened with this guy. Obviously. And all of them, they all renounce their fucking shit at the end of the documentary. They're all in touch with her. And they're like, "Thank you. Thanks to you, I don't fucking..." All of them. Every single one she talked to on there. Not Richard Spencer and the other...
No, guy. Not that queen. He's still he's voguing in the dark.
He's still like...
Lindsey Graham. And Ted Haggard.
Yeah, that's... I mean, and I bet you a lot of this shit... I mean, the sheer level of people that gotten, like, sexually assaulted or molested is got to be unreal.
Oh, yeah.
And you can tell, like, people's damage. Like, Barry always used to do that, you know, like, you just ask, like, well, what is it? Like, what happened to you? And then a lot of people don't get it. And
Barry Crimmins?
There's a very, as he used to say, like a lot of bizarre behavior might be somebody's ingenious survival strategy to get through their death.
Well, so, I had a girl that I did counseling for, and she was with this. It was like a couples counseling thing I did, and the guy called me up and he said, "Look, my girl, she keeps cheating on me. She was 25 years old. She was stripping, and she was a stripper, so she's probably smoking hot, and she really liked him." But so I first thing I go when I say, "Were you ever molested?" She goes, "Yeah." And I go, "At what age?" And she goes, 11. And I go, it was interesting because I said, "Well, let me explain to you that there's this phenomenon, because as an 11-year-old, you think that, you know, sex and intimacy is supposed to be, sex is supposed to maintain intimacy." And then the people who are adults who look at you and go, "Hey, you're looking up to these adults."
It's like a dirty, bad thing where I do this with losers because I'm bad. And then.
It's also kind of like, like poison. It's like you're poisoning their concept of intimacy. And you if you got an eyedropper full of arsenic, it doesn't it doesn't hurt you as much as if you put it in a gallon of water, or if you put it in, if you drink. So you're diluting this intimacy with multiple sex partners, because intimate sex is just sex. There is no intimacy in it, so it's watering down, and that's what you come up with when you're 11 years old. The problem is somebody is
they get 40, frozen. You get frozen at that age. Yeah.
It's like going. It's like doing prison. Like when people, remember when I'm gonna get you, sucker. Antonio Fargas comes out with the same, with the goldfish in the shoes, because he's frozen in that moment, and he never. And so you're living this life.
He comes out of the prison the way he went, wearing what he went in the 70s.
Yes,
Buck Rogers.
And then he goes, and then he comes out, but he's living. You're living a life. And you've learning different social engagements, different ways to deal with different social situations, but you never reassess the tragedy or the trauma with the information that you have as a 40-year-old person, and so you're still acting in the same way you were acting when you were 11 years old to deal with that trauma. And so it just continues. And so a lot of times just recognizing that this is what you're doing, I mean, it doesn't change it, but the recognition of it can get you to the point where you start to go down that creek. I need to change my thinking. And she just, and just saying that to her made her go like, bing, oh shit. Like, I never even thought of it that way. I mean, sometimes people are just not, they don't have the intellectual acuity to kind of make the connection.
It could be hard,
Yeah. I mean, but you got to, and it's never easy. I mean, it's always hard.
It can be hard, but you're never going to fix it without it, though.
You got to make a different decision. You eventually have to make a different decision.
Wait, Dante, hold on. I'm sorry. I got to fix something. One second.
Yeah.
Hold on.
There we go. Kurt fixing the background, apparently, of his beautiful San Francisco estate.
It's on, his background is on fire.
He wants to make it more accurate. Boy, 2020 something else. I forget. It was a gender reveal party that started this, but did you find out the gender? What was the gender? We never found out.
I'm going to say it was a purple cake. It was purple fireworks.
There we go. Did everything went off?
That's why it went. That's what happened.
Oh, 2020. It was a mix. Fantastic.
But yeah, that it was a really interesting thing with that, how this chick was literally still living as this 10-year-old who had been molested.
There's a lot of people who do that. There's a lot of people even without that level of tragedy that still.
Oh yeah, every.
I don't know why people freeze where they freeze, but
We don't reassess our thinking when it comes to this stuff. We just, this becomes our code or our instructions, and then we just go back to the same. This is okay. When a particular problem comes up, we assess it and we go, okay, this is how we affect this problem. Here's the problem. How do I, you go back into the file cabinet and you go, oh, this is how I handle it. Oh, I'm feeling intimacy towards somebody. Oh, I got to go fuck somebody. Let me go get a threesome. Let me go make out with a girl. Let me go, Then you over and over again, you have this kind of flow chart of when the trauma comes, and that's how you deal with it. Yeah, this girl was definitely, she was definitely in love with this dude, and every time she felt intimacy to him, she would go and have a threesome with one of her stripper friends and one of the guys. It was just, this is how, let's water it down. We gotta water it down, water it down. So it's just a way of protecting themselves. So it's a really crazy thing. It's just, and the funny thing about, it's that you've always looked at things very logically, and you've always done, like a girl would be like, well, then I'm gonna go. If that's you, I'm gonna leave. And Kirk would be like, all right, I guess you're leaving. And then
that shit I'm logical about. The things I would say is where I would be like pure, where I have a pure fucking triggered effect would be anything of like being blamed for something. That's like the kind of abuse I get, is like these crazy things where like I'm in trouble for, I haven't done anything and I'm in trouble for something crazy
that I didn't do.
And I got a real intense thing about that. So
right.
Some kind of fights I would be in would be because of that. It'd be because of some bullshit thing that you know, where someone's telling me what my motives are.
Yeah.
And it's, and it, it triggers the, all the PTSD from childhood, like immediately, like.
Right.
You know, so I'm not logical with that. Like, or I mean, I don't have a girlfriend, so.
What would you say is the last phase or the last sort of moments that you were very emotional, and it wasn't a logical, and your thought process wasn't based in the logic?
I mean, any kind of breakup when I'm angry in a fight, probably.
Yeah.
You know.
For me, it's always been like I always say I was a very, as a kid, I was very afraid and bullies. It's like I was afraid to fight. I just got tired of being afraid. And yeah, so right. The fear cure, but my coping with it was to rush into it, like run into the fire. Right.
Mm-hmm.
And so,
yeah,
and
no, then, I know that feeling, yeah.
And then the aggressiveness of that made everybody go like, oh, this motherfucker's crazy. And then people wouldn't fuck with me. They would never try and bully me because of the fact that, oh, this guy, he's crazy. But I was really just dealing with my own personal fear. And
yeah, like any fucking like that. I know exact feeling. It's like, yeah, like what primates fucking do.
Yeah.
And, you know,
fight or flight. It's fight or flight. Yeah, and mine was always fight. Yeah, mine was always fight. It was always fight. And then I had to come to the conclusion where, because then you get addicted to that too. Right. You get addicted to the prestige of having people like tiptoeing around you. And to,
well, so, comedy kind of does that. You know, the thing of comedy of like the fear of that and rushing into it.
Yeah.
Like I wanted to, and I remember when I first started, like how, you know, like a lot of people, they do well their first, like I did okay my first time, and then like I fucking bombed my second time or something, and then I remember feeling like, oh, why did I even think I could do this, kind of.
Mm-hmm.
I had like a thing of like, I want to go into this thing that I'm afraid of, you know what I mean?
Now, if you had bombed the first time, would it have been, would have it affected you the same way, or the fact that you did well the first time?
I don't think I did well. No, I was just thinking I was always going to do.
Yeah.
And it's because it was like there's some kind of reckless aspect to it that where I'm like, I don't give a fuck. Like, I'm just doing this.
Was it also kind of the agency that you had hovering over you from
it was Jehovah's thing like
Witness?
That,
yeah.
I fucked, you know, I kind of fucked up. I got like bad ADHD. Like, I really do. And I it was just a thing that I didn't fuck up that I stuck with completely.
Mm-hmm.
And then the rush, like whatever serotonin hit you get from it as compared
from winning.
To winning.
Yeah.
Like, you know, I stopped doing artwork generally since I did comedy. Here and there I did, but the rush, whatever the high is so much more immediate you know, intense than the other stuff. So I just went to that, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But definitely like a I don't give a fuck, because I already was, the world's supposed to be already over by now.
Like, yeah, a couple of times. Jehovah's Witness had a couple of dates that they was kept when adjusting. I was born. Right, you were supposed to end when you were born. Really? Yeah.
Well, it was like a faction within it, but you know, they had a built-in thing of like the light keeps getting brighter as we near end times, which is like a catch-all, get out of jail free on fucking
up. Right, right. And then they also say when the end of times, like Jehovah's Witness predicts the end of the world. If they've done it several times. Well,
the Bible does.
But, yeah. You know, they do a math thing. They do a weird math thing about it.
Not quite that, but what it is all these people who do this are interpreting Revelation. Now, no one's supposed to be given a date. Just off the bat, that's wrong, because and I think the person who printed that, who was putting that in the Watchtower, that was what they were doing. They're like, well, Adam was born on this day 6,000 years ago.
Right.
So, and that's very common. Then it became, for Jehovah's Witnesses, like, but their main thing was, there's a scripture that says, this generation will by no means pass away until all these things have come to pass. And the signs of the time are like wars in one place. There are all these things that are always happening, by the way.
Right, right, right.
But World War I was the big significant war. So then it's interpreted as that generation
who 1945. Yeah.
The world's going to end before they're all dead. I think they're dead now.
But, yeah.
But that was the thing. Like, oh, it's like any minute. And now they're doing big numbers because like shit's fucking, you know, I was telling my mom about it. I'm like, yeah, it looks like very Armageddon. Like, but it's because you live in fucking America. Like, if you live in fucking Iraq, it's been like that.
Yeah. Like, yeah. Yeah, yeah.
It's very local, you know, the thing.
Yeah, and then it's finding the symbols. It's sifting through the rubble to find the symbols. Well, oh, this was works. This and that. Yeah, yeah. When the End of Times didn't come out, Jehovah Witness said, no, well, actually, this is when the beginning of the End of Times.
They do a better one. They have better.
Really, better than that.
They go, no, the fact that it didn't come yet means you should be even more aware because it could be any minute.
Yeah.
So there's always a thing out of the revelation. And the reason it has a lot of staying power is because it always works. It was written at a certain time in code about the politics of the time. I think with like Nero or whoever, who was like very much persecuting him. Right. And so you can take these symbols and apply them. You're like, well, the king of the North is Vladimir Putin. So they all got their theories of
how it fits in.
Yeah, we didn't have a thing that there's going to be an antichrist. That's actually not really from the Bible at all. It's more like, I can't remember what the term for these people are, but that's from like the late 1800s that started springing up. Yeah. The rapture is not a thing in the Bible. But that's not a thing that we had.
Right. But
the other thing about the wild beast roaming the earth, which, you know, I'm sure you've heard people like Obama was the beast or, you know, Trump is the beast. Like people plug in there, but it wasn't our thing was the beast represents America. Or that rides the beast drunk on the blood of the prophets is the church's organized religion, which at the time when they made that up, it was kind of true. The church, that was back when there was more of like a religious thing was the whore. But now it's not that. People aren't like religious like that. Now it's like the media is the whore riding the beast, you know? So you can always plug in people.
You can plug it in. It's like Nostradamus. Yeah. They always, after the fact, they go, okay, this matches with this after the fact.
He's not even as good, I think. I think his are like really fucking...
Yeah, they really were. Yeah.
I think just having that imagery, it's just like lizard people. Like metaphorically, it's totally true. Like they're fucking lizard people at the top. I don't think they're lizard people from another dimension.
You don't think they have,
but they also kind of are also
kind of shitty. Kind of don't. Yeah, give a
just
fuck.
People that turn into fucking lizards. So it kind of works. So you know, it, depending on your intelligence or whatever, your gullibility, you go, oh, they must be real lizard. Whatever helps you get through.
Yeah, I get you. Kurt, thank you, man. Thank you so much, bro. I appreciate you, bro. I miss you, man. Buddy. I miss you being back in the city. Yeah, definitely will. I'll definitely come on. Plug your pod and everything.
Oh, yeah. So Can't Get Rights on Gas Digital. And it's, I think you watch on Gas Digital live today. Maybe it's already on. I don't know. But I had Ryan Long.
Okay.
And then I'm doing these sketches. Especially go on YouTube because I want to get the numbers up on all the stuff I do with Kyle Dunnigan. Kyle Dunnigan's YouTube channel.
Okay.
We did Pussies, review Star Wars, Pussies podcast, and Time Cancer's up. He has a lot of great shit, but that's the stuff I did with him. And, go up, the Kyle Dunnigan's / Patreon is the where you can get the bonus pay shit.
Cool. Thank you, bro. Cool. Harry, talk to me.
You can go to get all my stuff, all my social media at Harry Terjanian. Still doing Catalyst Wrestling. You can find all those clips online as well. And also check out the Man School 202 YouTube page. That's where everything is going down right now.
Yeah, check it out. Follow me on all my social media. Go to DanteNero.com. If you want a consultation, go to DanteNero.com. Click on consult and you can book some time with me. GYBB, get your balls back. WWDD, what would Dante do? The sexual revolution is being podcasted. I love y'all, man. The Patreon is coming up within the next week. What is it? Man School 202 Patreon?
That's what it is, man.
All right, so y'all can look up that and then get the bonus content. I appreciate you, bro. Thank you, man.
Yo, thank you, brother.
Always the best. Man School 202 is created by Dante Nero, hosted by Dante Nero, with Harry Terjanian and Andre D. Thompson, produced by Harry Terjanian, executive producers Matt Kleinschmidt, Harry Terjanian, and Dante Nero.